1917, directed by Sam Mendes, opens with a musical feature that will be with us for the remainder of this two-hour breathless journey. A deep drone. A heavy, leaden sound that establishes the base level of tension in the film. Music in any film plays a significant role, but it would be almost impossible to imagine 1917's story being as effective without Thomas Newman's score. This is partly because the score itself is so well crafted, but it's also because of the way the film is constructed. 1917's single continuous shot envelops the viewer from the first frame. It's like watching theatre. Our attention isn't diverted by cuts or scene changes, but held in a fixed position, bringing the other half of the audiovisual experience, which includes the music, into even greater focus. We're not distracted by the visual language of the film, and so the music becomes one of the most important narrative voices, guiding the story throughout and propelling our protagonists forward on their journey. The music at the beginning of the film establishes the tone for everything that will follow.
Blake.
As we meet Blake and Schofield,
Blake.
We get the feeling that we're entering a world that is weighed down by the heavy burden of war. We haven't really been shown anything yet, and we don't know what is going to happen next, but the music already gives us a sense of the context for this story. As they descend into the trenches, we hear a slowly descending string line. One of many examples of visual and musical pairings, and eventually the music quietly disappears.
In your own time, gentlemen. Is there any news, Sarge? News or what?
This is the first moment of musical silence in the film, creating a new, unnervingly quiet sound world. This allows the film and tension to settle briefly before we learn what lies ahead for Blake and Schofield.
It is a direct order to call off tomorrow morning's attack.
And before we hear about Blake's personal stakes in this story.
We will lose two battalions. 1,600 men, your brother among them.
After a growling electronic pedal and low cluster chords, yes. The score kicks in with a tight, compressed, rhythmic ostinato. We hear a rattling idea on bongos and a pulsing figure in electronics and percussion. The music mirrors Blake's emotional state. He, unlike Schofield, has no doubt about taking on the task. So the tension here comes not from whether he will undertake the journey, but more from the fear of what might happen if he didn't move quickly.
You would say that, because it's not your brother, is it?
In this short first act, the music rises and falls in intensity with the narrative, pushing the story on and carefully controlling the levels of tension. But as they go over the top into no man's land, the score adopts a different character. Where the music we have just heard spoke of Blake's clarity of purpose, this music feels unsettlingly ambiguous. Waves of electronic clusters and drones flow like a cold wind over the empty landscape, mirroring the rise and fall in diegetic noise, the sound of flies and mud, and the creak of barbed wire. This is desolate music for a desolate land, the ominous hum of something just out of view. But as Blake and Schofield start to make progress, the music begins to change. The electronic drone remains, but we now hear a new repeating piano figure with a sequence of two 2-4 bars and one bar of 3-4. It's harmonically unsettled, alternating between D minor and D major, but with that third bar of 3-4, the music feels as though it's tripping over itself, physically pushing it and our protagonists forward. As they rise out of the crater and make their way towards the German trenches, this idea is taken over by strings and a dulcimer. Brass chords then appear in the middle of the texture, adding to the harmonic weight of the sound and giving it an aggressive, biting quality. This is the first time that the score has really opened up. It's the first time when we really question whether or not they're going to make it. This sequence is a perfect example of how the score builds and curates tension. But the score is not just there to build tension, it's also there to relieve it. After they escape from the German trenches and as they make their way towards Ercoust, we hear the first real moment of softness in the music. Warm strings accompany Blake and Schofield's conversation, and we eventually hear these quiet, modal piano chords as they begin to talk about their lives before the journey that brought them together.
I didn't lose mine. What happens to me then?
A moment of lightness, or at least calm, mirrored in the music. The tense electronic drones of the trenches turned into hushed and introspective sounds of friendship and recollection.
I hated it.
In retrospect, this music seems to be resetting us emotionally for what is going to happen next. The tension rises as Blake and Schofield explore the farmhouse, but despite not finding anything, the tension in the music doesn't subside, continuing to maintain and build the intensity. For Schofield, Blake's death comes completely out of nowhere. But for us, it feels like dramatic irony, foreshadowed by the music. As Blake lies in Schofield's arms, the electronic drones continue, but they now feel different somehow. Instead of being full of tension and movement, the music feels stationary, locked in position, with only a shallow pulse keeping it alive, holding us on an in-breath.
I've been hit.
Up until this point, this had been Blake's story. Schofield was a passenger, reluctant to engage or care about the journey. But this is his story now, and with this shift in framing, the music now changes. Although we don't hear anything for the moments after Blake's death, as Schofield begins to recall his story to the soldiers that found him, and as he begins to realise what's happened, we hear one of the most tender moments in the score. A solo cello laments Blake's death, an expression of anger and loss felt internally, but heard through the score. This is his music now. And from this point onwards, not only seems to be tied to his emotional state, but also seems to be actively pushing him forwards. Schofield heads off by himself, and after a tense encounter with a German soldier, he's knocked out. And as he wakes, we hear in the score the same repeating figure that accompanied Blake and Schofield's journey across No Man's Land, this time played by a celeste. The music is giving him life, giving him the courage to continue. He pushes onwards, and the energy in the music that's been held back up until this point is released, starting a chain reaction. As Schofield escapes through the town, strings begin by singing out rich, strident chords that, although based around a minor harmonic language, feel uplifting and almost spiritual in nature. Underneath the texture, an arpeggiated figure in cellos then adds to the sound, giving life to the harmony as light from German flares illuminates the broken facades of now derelict buildings. Schofield runs, and brass join the orchestral choir, creating a cathedral of sound. Filtering through the air as the light grows, and then fades into the blackness. Every beat in this music encourages Schofield on, propelling him to the end of his journey. Schofield eventually escapes the town by jumping into the river, and by chance comes across a group of British soldiers. It's at this point that we hear the only example of diegetic music in the film. A simple folk song sung by one of the soldiers. A moment of calm before the breaking of the wave, before the storm that awaits them.
The Devons. I have to find the Devons.
Where are the Devons?
The music begins a fast, rhythmic ostinato on top of a melody and cellos and double basses.
Why haven't you gone over?
We're the second wave.
We, like Schofield, don't know if he is going to make it, but he is going to try. As he forces his way through the crowds, the percussive elements of the score become increasingly present. Every repetition of this chord sequence introduces a new element, busier string lines, richer harmony, and deep, earthy brass. We never get any sort of completion or resolution here, just repeated minor modal chords under the percussive ostinato. And as Schofield realizes what he must do, as he realizes that the only way to stop the attack is to go over the top, the music surges into life. Brass and percussion accompany his heroic effort. Horns, trombones, timpani, clashing cymbals, and a counter melody in violins all give him the strength to complete his journey. But the music hasn't reached its conclusion yet. It retreats into itself, returning to the electronic drone as Schofield delivers the message to stop the attack.
This attack is not to go ahead. You have been ordered to stop. You have to stop.
The music throughout 1917 has been full of tension, but has proven to be far more than just a tool to serve the story. It has become the story. It's become the force that has pushed Schofield onwards. And so the resolution of the music can only come at the very end of his journey, when Schofield delivers on the promise that he made to the man who saved his life. After he finds Blake's brother, the tension in the music is finally released, and the solo cello returns. A moment of stillness, a trembling breath out. This cathartic melody reminds us of what has been lost throughout this journey, but it also reminds us of the connection that's been formed between two people, in spite of the circumstances. Even against a backdrop of chaos and darkness, friendship and love can still be found. Thank you so much for watching. I've been meaning to do a video on Thomas Newman's music for such a long while, so it's amazing to be able to finally do it. I love this film, and I was completely gripped when I first saw it. If you enjoyed this video, do take a look at my other film score analyses linked in the description below, and take a look at my Patreon account if you'd like to support my work. See you next time.